The 28th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. And sorry, bear with me. There we go. Hopefully, that's the only issue we have this morning. Apologies have been received from Elena Whittam. I would also like to congratulate Elena on her appointment as Community Safety Minister and thank her for all the work on the committee. I welcome Evelyn Tweed, who will be attending as a substitute this morning. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item 4 in private. Are we all agreed? Agreed. We now turn to our main item of business this morning. Item 2 is the consideration of a statutory instrument, the Homeless Persons Suspension of Referrals Between Local Authorities Scotland Order 2022 draft. The Scottish Government advises this order would suspend the discretionary power of local authorities to refer a homelessness applicant without a local connection to another local authority based on the applicant's local connection to that area. I welcome Shona Robison, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government. Cabinet Secretary, thank you for attending today. I also welcome officials joining us today, Karen Grieve, Legislation and Programme Strategy Team Leader, Louise Thompson, Homelessness Policy Manager, and Michaela West, Solicitor, Housing Branch, Scottish Government. I hope I got your name right there. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Good morning and thanks, Convener and members of the committee, for the invitation to today's session. The proposed change to local connection referrals between local authorities in Scotland was a recommendation made in 2002 by the Homelessness Task Force and picked up again in 2018 by the Homelessness and Rough Sleeping Action Group. In short, local connection has been recognised as a barrier to accessing homelessness services in Scotland for 2 decades, and now we are removing it. We made changes in late 2019 so that investigating local connection became a discretionary power rather than a legal duty for local authorities. And this means that at the moment, households can still be asked to demonstrate their local connection to the area when they present as homeless to a local authority. Most homeless households want to live in an area where they are already settled within their community. However, for some households, application of the local connection test is a barrier to securing a settled home. Choice is important, and homeless households should be able to freely move to a new area like anyone else. This could be to access support, to take advantage of employment opportunities, or simply to have a fresh start. The number of households who present as homeless with no local connection to the local authority is low. Currently, around 5% of all households assessed as homeless or threatened with homelessness. When there is no local connection established, local authorities have the power to refer the homeless household back to the area where they do have a local connection. However, local authorities seldom use these referral powers, which suggests that they are already operating in a person-centred way following the legislative change in 2019. Our 2019 consultation showed that there is broad support for the changes to local connection from homelessness stakeholders, local authorities and our lived experience group, the Change Team. However, we know that some local authorities have raised concerns as to the timing of laying this legislation, as they are already under pressure to deliver their homelessness duties. Big cities such as Glasgow and Edinburgh are seen as attractive places to live, with a wide range of support services and employment opportunities available. Our island communities are also concerned that even a small increase in homeless households can have a significant impact on support services such as health and social care. So a robust monitoring and evaluation framework has been developed with stakeholders, and through regular engagement with local authorities and services, we can capture trends as they emerge. And this will provide the evidence base for mitigations should a disproportionate adverse effect on local authorities be identified. And as you know from my previous correspondence with the committee, we have delayed this SSI a number of times to support local authorities, but we are determined to improve access to housing and support for homeless households, and so we are moving forward with these changes now. Finally, convener, safety, stability and support are all affected by where people live, and I see the ending of local connection referrals in Scotland as an important step in removing barriers experienced by homeless households, making sure households receive a consistent service and offering them opportunities available to other Scottish households. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We will now move on to questions. Our questions will be directed to you, but you're obviously, of course, welcome to invite any official to respond. I'll open up the questions this morning with quite a general one. I'd be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary could expand on why the Scottish Government believes that this is the right approach.
Okay, well, I think just to start with, the fact that Scotland has some of the strongest rights in the world for people experiencing homelessness, but at the moment, as local connection powers are discretionary, there is a risk of inconsistent practice across the country, and that can result in some homeless households receiving a different service in one area compared to another. And ending the referral powers will result in, I suppose, a more consistent service across Scotland for homeless households. And I think when people make a homelessness application in another local authority, they'll have good reasons for doing so. As I said in my opening statement, that might be to be closer to family or a job opportunity, or they might want to use services that aren't available in their area, or indeed a fresh start because they didn't feel safe in their previous home. So we have listened to people's experiences, and we've built this on the basis of listening to those experiences. And of course, changing the rules on local connection has been a long-standing commitment. It's not something that has just come to light recently. And it has been informed by experts in the homelessness sector. And as I said again in my opening statement, the bones of this go back as far as 2002 when this was first raised. So I think, you know, we have delayed, but we feel now is the right time to move forward with this.
Thank you very much. I will now move on to questions from members, and I will bring my colleague Emma Rodican.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary did touch on this in her opening statement. There have been concerns raised by some local authorities with very specific housing issues around how they might be able to cope with aspirational applications and presentations for homelessness. For example, the Highlands and Islands, which is a great place to live. There may be people who present there not realising the geography, and that if they are allocated a house, say, in Caithness, they might be a good few hours away from the support services that they thought they would be closer to. Now, the Cabinet Secretary did touch on monitoring. Could she expand on how situations like this will be recorded and monitored so that this committee can scrutinise them in future?
Happy to do so. I think, I mean, first of all, just in terms of the context, I said in my opening statement that there was, I think, about 5% of households didn't have a local connection to the local authority they presented to. And there were less than 200 referrals last year, and 11 councils didn't make any referrals, and 13 had made 5 or fewer referrals. So we're not talking about huge numbers of people and huge increases. However, having said that, we recognise that we have to absolutely monitor and observe and keep an eye on any trends. So first of all, we did complete an island community impact assessment with engagement from each of the 6 island local authorities, and we the island and rural local authorities, to make sure that we were listening to their issues that Emma Roddick has just articulated. And the monitoring and reporting framework has been developed in collaboration with with them, with frontline services and with the with those with lived experience to capture relevant information to support the data already gathered through HL1. And monitoring the statistics will be a really important way of understanding the impact of the legislation. And what we have said is that if there are any indications of difficulties, then we will directly engage with that local authority to look at how we support them. I mean, I guess the backstop would be if there is an emergency situation created in an area, there is the potential to come forward with an exemption, which would require me to come back to Parliament with that. I would really only want to do that in extremis, and I don't anticipate that needing to be done, because I think local authorities will manage the situation, and with our support, I think we will be able to help them to address additional applications that come in. But again, happy to come back to the committee perhaps after a period of time of implementation with an update report, if that would be helpful to give the committee further information at that point.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the detailed answer, and I'm glad to hear about engagement with folk with lived experience, particularly in the islands. Could she expand a little more on the wider engagement that was done with lived experience groups?
Yeah, so the change team who sit around the table at the homelessness strategic group that I attend have been absolutely fantastic at ensuring that all measures and developments within homelessness policy, services, legislation are checked against for those who have lived experience. And the change team has drawn a huge number of people with varied experience of accessing homelessness services, the input is absolutely critical to make sure that any changes that are made or any issues that we need to address further are identified and highlighted by those with lived experience, I would certainly encourage the committee, if they haven't already, to engage with the change team, because they are an amazing group of people.
Thanks, Emma. I'll now move to questions from Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Shelter Scotland warmly welcome this change and state this will embed the no wrong door approach. They also welcome a person-centred approach. Would the Cabinet Secretary like to comment further on the shelter briefing?
I certainly welcome the support and statement shared with the committee by Shelter Scotland, which I think does recognise that this is an important step in improving outcomes for homeless households and giving those households the same ability to move as any other household would have. And I know that Shelter does obviously very much advocate on the behalf of the rights of people experiencing homelessness, and they do see this as a strong step in the right direction of supporting a person's right to choose where they live. And they've been advocating this for quite some time, and as I say, are content that we have now brought this forward after having delayed for good reason, obviously because of COVID and then because of Ukraine. But we feel now is the right time to move forward, and that to delay any further would not be right.
Thanks. I'll now move to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning to your officials as well. I think we all understand the rationale for the legislation and by and large support it. As an Edinburgh MSP, I do have my concerns, though, where we currently are in the capital with the availability, and I think Glasgow members would have the same, of homelessness accommodation. So I wanted to ask what impact assessment and potential additional support services and also homeless accommodation will be needed, and what work's been undertaken around that for potential referrals to the capital and other cities.
Thanks for that. So let me just go back to the numbers, which are relatively small. In the latest figures we have, 2021-22, Edinburgh made 10 referrals, Glasgow 20. So, I mean, not minimising that, but I think we need to see it in some context of the overall number of applications. So they are relatively small. Now, I am aware, obviously, that there are pressures within Glasgow and Edinburgh. I have engaged very directly with the housing conveners of both cities. And I think we need to see the solutions as part of the kind of wider housing system. And they're not the same in Glasgow and Edinburgh. They both have different challenges. And what I have said to both, and again, I've reiterated that in a letter that I issued yesterday to them, is that I am very keen to work with both and those other local authorities that have, for example, the highest number of people in temporary accommodation, to look at what solutions they can bring forward, because they know their local areas better than I do, and how we can support them with those solutions, and to be quite ambitious with those solutions. And I have offered to look very favourably on solutions that can be brought forward with some evidence of how that's going to impact on resolving and reducing the numbers of people in temporary accommodation and helping to reduce homelessness within both cities more generally. So the monitoring framework, of course, will be important in monitoring any impact on Glasgow, Edinburgh, or anywhere else for that matter. And, you know, we'll continue to engage with them. But, you know, I can't stress enough, how open I've been with them to come forward with solutions that they think can make the difference. And I look forward to engaging with them further on that.
Can I ask, have the councils expressed concern to you on this issue as well? Because, you know, I've raised with you several times the issue around IJB funding, which has meant the capital's lost out on resources. So we're not in a great place in the first place here in the capital. So I just wondered if these concerns have already been put to you.
So there's mixed views within local authorities, it's fair to say. And some have, but others not. So there's not a consistent view across local authorities. Clearly, within the homelessness sector and experts, they're very clear that this is the right thing to do. And it's not that those local authorities that raised any concerns said we shouldn't do it. I think it was more about the timing. And I listened to that in terms of COVID and in terms of Ukraine, and that's why we delayed, maybe to the frustration of some of the homelessness stakeholders, actually. So these things are always a balance. But I feel that, you know, it isn't right 20 years on from this first being raised that we don't move forward with this. But what I have said is that, you know, we will monitor any impact, and we will work with those individual local authorities to help overcome any issues. And as I started off with my comments, I have said very clearly to particularly Edinburgh and Glasgow that my door is open, and I am keen to hear and receive proposals of how we can help to help them move forward with some of the particular challenges that they have, and that is continued to be the case.
Thank you. Thanks, Deputy Convener.
Thanks, Miles. I'll now move on to questions from Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning to your team. I wonder if I can just follow up a couple of questions from my colleague, Miles Briggs. I don't want to keep this Edinburgh-centric, but most people within Edinburgh, if they're in temporary accommodation, are there for 2 years. Can I just seek clarification? If somebody makes an application, do they go onto that temporary accommodation list, or do they jump the list and go straight to find accommodation, which is obviously very scarce within Edinburgh?
Well, I'll bring officials in, but obviously it would depend on their circumstances. So their homelessness application would be assessed in terms of the needs, as would any homelessness application. I don't know, Louise, do you want to say a little bit more?
Yeah, I think I would echo what the Cabinet Secretary had said there. The application would be treated as any other applicant, the difference being that their local connection status isn't taken into account.
OK, so have we worked out? I appreciate the numbers relatively are very low, but if you're waiting 2 years for a permanent house, that can be a long time, you know, that's a very long time to wait in temporary accommodation. So, of the people who you've looked at previously, how many of those would go into temporary accommodation and how many would go straight into a more permanent place? Do we know, do we have those figures?
I think those would be figures that Edinburgh would have, because it will change depending on the availability of accommodation at the time. I mean, not everybody who requires accommodation in Edinburgh goes into temporary accommodation. It will depend on their circumstances, the availability of properties to meet their needs. So we know, for example, that one of the reasons that families are ending up in temporary accommodation is quite often because there's not an available, suitable home to meet their needs. So it's about matching, obviously, the needs of the person with the accommodation available. But I would stress, you know, Edinburgh made 10 referrals in 2021-22, so the figures are small. Having said that, I'm not going to underestimate the challenge that Edinburgh has with temporary accommodation, which is why, looking at it from that lens, it's not really the local connection that is the issue for Edinburgh. It's the number of people who, and the availability of stock and the numbers, therefore, going into temporary accommodation because they can't be matched with a home that meets their needs. That is where we need to resolve the problem. And I can't stress enough that, you know, we need to think a little bit outside the box. So, you know, for example, one of the opportunities of some of the quite imaginative thinking that's going on around the Ukraine programme is to look at other more innovative solutions around, you know, modular build that I know has been raised, was raised in the chamber during the Ukraine statement around, you know, are there sites available to perhaps do some more kind of rapid development of housing that may have more general application beyond the Ukraine programme? We really need to think about imaginative solutions, and I've opened the offer is there on the table to Edinburgh and others, other areas that have got a particular problem with housing availability and temporary accommodation, to come forward with ideas, and we will help to make those happen. So I think we need to look at the whole housing system in Edinburgh rather than, I think, the local connection is not really the issue for Edinburgh here. It's more the housing system in Edinburgh that we need to get into more of a balance.
Okay, thank you. On a more general point, if I read the regulations right, this is a suspension rather than a removal. And I'm just wondering why you've gone down that road, and how long do you intend the suspension to last? Is that because you want to do a further review, or is this like a, you know, a suspension when 20 years' time people will forget it's been a suspension?
Michaela, do you want to?
To that, we've used the language of suspension because this is a suspension specific to Scottish local authorities and referrals between Scottish local authorities. So we've kept in place in the provision the ability to refer elsewhere. So yeah, the language of suspension is it's just specific to that specific local authority.
So it's within the 32 local authorities.
Yeah.
Which kind of leads me to my next question. I'm wondering, you know, if I live in Blackpool or wherever down in England and have a local connection with, say, Inverness, this doesn't apply to me, does it? Is that what, so if I live out with Scotland local authorities, even if I have a connection with a very strong connection with a local authority area, I can't use this. Is that right?
So there's alternative legislation in England and in Wales that deals with the same thing, with referrals between local authorities across England, Wales and Scotland. And so I think, if you were to present to an English local authority and have a connection in Scotland, you may be referred at their discretion back up, although I can't completely talk to the English legislation. Does that answer your question?
I think so, yeah. So, but I'm not quite sure why we've gone down the road of suspension rather than removal. I just didn't quite understand your answer. I wonder if you could maybe elaborate slightly further on that. Why not just remove this completely?
Well, because I think it leaves... The suspension is within the 32 local authorities in Scotland, so it still leaves the power in relation to someone from a local authority out with Scotland.
OK. Yeah. OK, that's helpful. And then my final question is, one of the issues that we've been grappling with as a committee is data collection around all areas. And I think you said this in your opening statement, but I wonder if you could just give us some kind of expansion in regard to how is the data collected and monitored, and will that be published in a public way so that we can see how this is working over a three or five-year period?
So, again, I'll bring officials in the detail, but some of that data is already collected, and this is about adding information on top of the information that's already there in terms of the monitoring and evaluation framework. Louise, do you want?
Yeah, so local authorities already give us regular data returns, which are published on an annual basis. So the sort of statistical side of things we've already been capturing, we don't want to duplicate that, so we will use that existing data. The sort of part that's been developed with local authorities, the change team and frontline services is much more around the qualitative side of information, really trying to capture the impact of what this legislation will have. So that will be gathered through regular engagement with our stakeholders, local authorities and our lived experience group, and that will be published as well.
Thank you. I will now move to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy, who will finish off our question today.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and their officials. I wanted to pick up on a couple of the themes, actually, that we've heard so far this morning. Since 2019, in Glasgow, the unsuitable accommodation order has been breached 220 times. And I wonder whether or not this is something that you're going to monitor as a result of bringing in this suspension?
Yes, we do monitor very closely the breaches, because obviously I'm concerned at any breaches. So we do monitor the unsuitable accommodation order breaches, and we will, that will be part of the package of information that we'll look at here. I think I go back to my original, one of my previous answers, that we need to look at the housing system as a whole to address, because we can address some of the issues around temporary accommodation. We can then tackle the unsuitable accommodation orders, and some local authorities are actually doing some quite imaginative things. So one local authority was talking at a recent housing event I attended, that they were getting far more upstream in identifying those households that potentially could end up homeless and in temporary accommodation. They were doing that through looking at, for example, people getting into council tax arrears as well as rent arrears, and by getting further upstream and helping those families earlier with their debts and their arrears, they were actually seeing the homelessness figures come down and those in temporary accommodation come down. So there is something about both tackling those presenting as homeless and tackling that issue, and obviously making sure we continue to expand the housing provision, and that we look at innovative ways of tackling temporary accommodation. But there's also something about prevention, and I'm really keen to look further at how we might get, you know, help families at a point before actually they end up in the homelessness system. And that's about drilling down into looking at folk who have ended up in temporary accommodation. What's their story of how did they get there? What happened and what were the opportunities for intervention? And I think the prevention duties that we're bringing forward are going to be important in that respect as well, because it's about looking at all of the opportunities to intervene and seeing it as everybody's business to ask the questions about, are folk getting into debt, into arrears? Is homelessness a potential consequence of that? And how can we really prevent that far, far earlier?
I welcome that and that approach. I can see how that would be more sensible than obviously getting someone into a homelessness situation or finding them and dealing with it at that point. So that's really helpful. Have you also considered, we spoke a little bit about Ukraine this morning, have you considered the impact of the people from Ukraine on this particular order?
Yes. And obviously we monitor that very carefully. As you'll be aware, the housing system around the Ukrainian displaced persons is a bit separate, because obviously they have the welcome accommodation and then trying to get them into host accommodation or the opportunities for the kind of private rented sector. So there's a lot of work going on. And of course, social rented sector, the £50 million that's been made available to local authorities to come forward with new accommodation, as in refurbished, repurposing. And we've had a good response from a number of local authorities. The latest one with the 500 units in Aberdeen that are going to be brought forward that were essentially needing refurbishment and had been seen as surplus to requirements. So we're trying to keep that housing stream a bit separate in order to create additional capacity. Obviously some... We need to keep a close eye on that, because we don't want... I think, well, let me say this as well. It's really important that the host accommodation opportunity is continued beyond 6 months. Now, we've obviously, there's been a number of changes with UK government around the... who's in charge of the programme. And I know that my colleague Neil Gray has been seeking urgent discussions around making sure that ability to keep hosts beyond the 6 months and is really, really important, because we don't want to see people, and I know that English local authorities are really concerned about this as well, we don't want to see people ending up out of host accommodation and then ending up presenting as homeless. That is really important. We don't see that. So making sure hosts can continue to host while people are then supported into more settled accommodation is really, really crucial. So all of these things are linked.
Thank you. I just have one final question. And I appreciate what's been said this morning about monitoring. I think that will be quite important for this. And I should have said at the start that I think this is a sensible thing to do, because I understand that if people want to be able to live where they want to live. So I think that's quite important. In the monitoring, if you were to find that there were particular local authorities that had quite an uptick in applications, possibly as a result of this particular suspension, is there an intention to provide funding to those local authorities to make sure that they can afford to meet the demand?
Well, we will look at the circumstances at the time of what interventions have already been made and what further interventions the local authority believe are necessary. But I go back to that wider discussion. We've already been very upfront with Glasgow and Edinburgh, for example, about, come and tell us what you think you need to do to tackle, for example, temporary accommodation issues in Edinburgh, and then we can have a conversation about how that's supported. We would want those local authorities to make full use of the allocations they've already received. For example, in Edinburgh, they've not fully utilised as yet their allocation of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, and we're wanting them to get on with that. And I know they've got a few things in the pipeline, but we need to see the full allocation used before any further resources are used. But what I have said is, you know, if Edinburgh or any other local authority with particular pressures around temporary accommodation comes to us and says, look, we think these are the kind of key things that we need to do, we can fund these ourselves, but we need a bit of assistance with this, I would look on that very favourably. If the evidence is there, it's actually going to make a difference. And those are the conversations that we're having.
And I'm sure local authorities will welcome it. Thanks.
Thanks all. We'll now move on to agenda item 3. Agenda item 3 is the formal consideration of motion S6M05955, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the Homeless Persons Suspension of Referrals Between Local Authorities, Scotland Order 2022. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move this motion.
Formally moved.
I now invite any contributions from members. No further contributions. I will invite the Cabinet Secretary to sum up and respond to the debate.
I think it's been a very constructive discussion, a lot of important points made. I will come back to the committee at some point in the future with an update on how this is working in practice, if that would be helpful to the committee. Thanks.
Absolutely, that would be very helpful. Thank you then. The question is that motion S6M05955 in the name of Shona Robinson MSP be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Great. We're all agreed. That's great. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course. I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and to your officials for coming this morning. Thank you. Before I close the public part of this meeting, I can advise that next week we will be taking evidence on the Scottish Government's National Care Service Scotland Bill. The committee will now move into private session, and members attending remotely are invited to join the private meeting via the link provided. Thank you.